Since 1991, Pro Taper has led the way in premium control components and prides themselves on providing an exciting, innovative, and complete product line to fulfill the needs of professional racers and weekend riders alike. Through revolutionary ideas like the oversized 1 1/8 inch handlebar and the micro handlebar kit, the only control system purpose-built for youth riders, Pro Taper continues to push the limits and transform how we experience riding our motorcycles. Visit ProTaper.com for more. Everyone, welcome to the Kickstart Podcast presented by Pro Taper. It is the Monday after a very spectacular Boston Supercross, or what are we going to call it, Foxborough?
Foxborough.
Foxborough Supercross. Wow, is all I could say about the weekend. You did a great job out there, Anton. Was it pretty freaking amazing in person? Like, on TV, it was spectacular.
Okay, so watching it in person, there were so many battles to keep an eye on that it was pretty good, but I just rewatched it again just now. I watched it on the flight home yesterday and then watched it again just now. So on the floor, you really can't see how close everything is, or like the ebb and the flow. Like, I knew that Ken made a push early, and then I knew he made another one in the middle, but I didn't realize how much he had broken away from Chase during that middle one. I didn't realize like some of Chase's line choices and stuff like that, which I'd like to get into later, and just how well he was riding the KTM and the things he was doing from the floor. But then when you watch it again from TV and you see the aggression, the line choices that they're carrying, especially when they would get on some of those hard pack sections and you would see him really crack the throttle open and then it just lays that nice big strip of gloss on the dirt. You can't see that from the floor, but then to see it again from TV, yeah, it makes the battle even crazier. So like in the moment, I realized it was a really, really good race, but then watching it back, and I have to say like TV coverage did a very good job this weekend for the multiple battles that were happening between Jet and Eli, the race for the lead, the passes that everybody had to make. That was a good one.
Yeah.
The split screen right at the end with Jet and Anderson. Whew. Yeah. That was tight. But man, it looks so dang slippery, man. There's a track in Los Angeles I used to race it as a kid called Ascot. Mm-hmm. Ascot Speedway. Dude, when they were coming out of those turns and just laying the shiny spots like that, I was just like, look at that. That's Ascot.
Yeah.
They wish that
was that like, is that what you were doing on your three wheeler? You were just three wheeling's a good feeling?
Yeah, I raced a motorcycle there too.
Yeah.
Raced a motorcycle there too, but three wheelers were better in the turns there.
Yeah.
So it was interesting. I really liked the track layout, but like that one section where they were really having a hard time keeping the rear end not from sliding out, they would cross the start straight, and it was like where they're entering the course and then coming or exiting. It like wasn't a perfect straight line, you know. So they were really trying to like turn but not slide out. I thought it was a really cool racetrack.
Dude, McAdoo did a Brody a couple times. And I was like, no, yeah. I thought he was gonna fall down, but
yeah.
Yeah, it was awesome.
That whole section right there, too, because it made that first turn seem really long because they had to go all the way around that inside berm. And then, as you said, Chase, the multiple elements that are there. But then when guys would do that step on, step off, and then make the right, during the race, you could see how hard they were trying not to push too far to the outside before going too wide to hit that tough block before the wall and then coming back in, same thing, then getting on the gas. And A-Ray, I'd really like to know how you guys are on this. Like what Don said, when they get on the gas like that, it feels so cool as a racer to know, like, yo, I can light the rear tire up at any minute. But in a race situation like that, and with how these race bikes are they getting on the gas so hard, like, I don't care at all if I'm losing any forward drive, I just have to go? Or are the bikes so tuned in that they are still driving forward and that's just the way things look?
Just sort of depends, right? I mean, you know, some of the guys, it goes a little bit to the fact, like, how they set their bike up. Some guys go like a little bit more of like a smoother power for whenever the track is like that. You know, they're able to get on the gas a little bit harder so you're not breaking, you know, the rear wheel. But I don't think a guy like me who's just like kind of a hammerhead would just hold the bike wide open. Obviously you've seen it, like whenever I flew off the track and there's a big burnout on the side of the track, you know. But that's probably not the smartest thing to do. The smartest thing to do would just be like roll on the throttle and just get as much traction as possible. Even if you're wide open, you're either wide open and you're spinning, or you're at like a half throttle or quarter throttle and you're still going the same damn speed. So yeah, I don't know if that dirt's so weird, man. It's so weird. I feel like a lot of the guys at the front were doing really, really well at just like hitting those like super small berms and then sort of pivoting and getting a straight line. And then that was sort of like the best case scenario for him. You know, mm-hmm. I think Sexton was really working that section, doing that on off and going to the outside and getting himself straight drive forward. Mm-hmm. I think that was like sort of like the best case scenario for it, sort of staying out of that shiny shit.
I asked that just because
did the sand section.
Sorry, Don. I asked that though, just because with the electronics that everybody has, like straight up, that is where traction control would come in. And to see it still play down like that, I mean, we see how those things are. So yeah, it's interesting to hear all of that. And then what you said about what Chase was doing, like when we go on later, I think that some of Chase's lines show how comfortable he is on that bike this weekend. Like he really turned a page on it.
Yeah.
It's crazy to just sort of see like how much different his bike looks now versus it did like at Anaheim 1. You know, his bike, it looks a little bit more freer. It looks more, honestly, it just looks like a lot softer all the way around. You know, suspension wise, it looks like it's more, it's able to soak up stuff. Like it looks super rigid and he just didn't look super comfortable on it at the beginning of the year. And I think now he's starting to get more of his style of setting on the bike, you know, like I guess with all of the changes that they made over at the Austrian group, you know, with him and his bike, I think that it's they're catering to his needs and, you know, I guess it's showing on the track, right? He's getting a little bit more comfortable on the KTM.
I agree. I think they're doing a lot of out of the box things for Chase and for actually all the guys. But hey, did that sand section almost seem like it didn't do anything? I mean, the guys are just kind of jumping over it, huh? It was a straight, hit a lot of run at it.
Yeah.
I mean, I never really saw sand flying. It was just
Yeah, it was a little bit of a more like different sand, right? Like it wasn't like super, super deep or anything of that sort. Maybe that was to do with the rain and stuff like that. But usually whenever you get that white, crappy sand that they get from a golf course that's super deep and like really washy, that's whenever you see a lot of the mistakes happen. But they have different types of sand, I think, whenever they dump on the track. I think, yeah, I mean, that one wasn't it just wasn't as deep as say, like, I don't know, one of like the Florida rounds or something like that, where it had like that super, super white sand.
I think it being wet played a part into it, because looking at the stuff, it looked like the sand pit that you, like the sand that you would buy in the bag for a kid's play box. Like, I'm pretty sure Ezra has same sand outside right now. And like pebbly looking stuff like that.
All thick and moist. Yeah.
Hey, Anton, were guys running mooses this past weekend just because of like all the bricks and how shitty the dirt is there?
See, it didn't seem too bad as far as all of that goes. And even on the track conditions of stuff, like as I had said in last week's show, I had never been to that one before. So anything that I had was like a preconceived notion of hearing how that gray dirt is really gravelly. But then with all the weather that they got and then the way that Dirtworks prepped the track and kept everything sealed, during Friday when I stepped out onto the track and early on Saturday, I was like, oh man, this is way different looking dirt. But then as the day dried out, it did turn back into what it is. And it's that gray stuff, but it didn't seem too bad. Like, yeah, there were some rocks and stuff to it, but it didn't seem like a bunch of foreign material and trash and terrible stuff like that. So I didn't hear anything about mooses.
How was the rain on Friday?
Sucked.
I mean,
it sucked.
Dirtworks guys obviously did an amazing job with the track. I mean, the infield, I think, had some had some mud bogs that got some guys. But was it just like on Friday, was it like, oh, my God, this is going to be a whole quagmire?
So Thursday was actually worse. Like, it rained pretty much all day on Thursday. And then through Thursday night, I left my window and my rental car cracked like that much. So I washed the inside of the Malibu out Thursday night on accident. So it did rain quite a bit then. And then on Friday, everything was okay. It was super windy, probably like winds in the 20s, 30s all day. And so knowing that they had that going on and knowing how much the wind is going to help. Dude, Gillette Stadium is like a vortex. It is a straight wind tunnel for whatever reason. There was like a constant cyclone going on next to the podium all night from that tunnel being open. So the Dirtworks crew knew, hey, we have this wind here. There is going to be clear skies, maybe even a little bit of late afternoon sun. So then they pulled the tarps off on Friday midday, which was really, really early. Usually they wait until Saturday, but then that gave them time to let the track bake in a little bit more. There was like one last band of rain that came through, but really what sucked on Friday was just, it was cold and windy. So nobody wanted to do anything. Like nobody was there. Nobody came outside. All the teams were trying to get as much work done as they could. But yeah, Friday's mood at the pits was lame. Like it just sucked. There was nothing really to do, which I think made Saturday seemed even more exciting, even though it was really, really chilly all day, just the highs in the 50s, still pretty windy and sunny skies. Everybody was ready to get fired up then. And it was, dude, it was cold all night too. You could see that everybody except one dude wore a jacket during the parade lap, and I was looking for as many layers as I could put on because it was really, really chilly.
Hey, when it started raining towards the end of the main event, you couldn't really tell on TV. Was it that bad, or was it just like a slight mist?
So it was really spotty all day on Saturday. Like, we'd be in the photo den, and everybody'd be getting ready to come out, and then somebody else would come running in ready to put on a full rain suit, and then you'd walk outside 5 minutes later, and it was clear again. And that probably happened four or five times through the day. And then at the night show, during the main event, it just spotted a little bit. I think enough to make things even more technical and maybe mess up vision a little bit. But, okay, so considering how bad the track seemed on Friday morning, the Dirtworks guys had to water it Saturday night before the night show. That's how much everything had changed around. And track was very, very good on Saturday night, all things considered.
Yeah.
It's just crazy to me that the only thing that wasn't covered was pretty much the start straight, right? All the rhythm sections, everything like that was covered, you know, from the track crew on Friday. And the way the track turned out, I mean, the most hard packed part of the track was, you know, the start straight, you know, and all of the, I mean, the rest of the track was super rutted, which is like crazy to me, right?
I like that steamroller that they're bringing. Yeah. Very Euro.
Mm. Yeah.
It'll be even more Euro if you, if the guy in the little bobcat starts doing intermission, you know. But hey, I was thinking about, this is like the best 450 Supercross season I can remember.
Dude.
I mean, we're four races ago with a tie. Was it six winners? Six different 450 winners or something?
I think five. Six?
I don't know, but it's just, I mean, in the weather, yeah, we keep going, oh man, there have been so many wet, soggy races and everything, but that's helped make it interesting, I think.
Yeah,
I mean, this has been an amazing season.
Yeah,
and I think the competitors, a lot of the guys are improving like at the same time. It's crazy. Like Chase seems to be finding his flow just as Eli really is. And I guess Chase is closer in the points right now at this point than he was last year. So it's unbelievable.
Yeah, and then injuries, knock on wood, I mean, haven't played a part, right?
Yeah.
The only guy that's out really is Ferrandis.
Yeah.
Ferrandis, AP, and then Christian Craig as well.
Weekend, yeah. Dean. But Dean will be back this week. So, like, it's been a little bit. But I was thinking this on Thursday because exactly what you guys said is true. Think about in some of the down years where we could see a breakaway championship happening, and there'd always be that talk of, oh, man, they got to implement a chase format and this, and this. And what if we went to playoffs for Supercross? We got that. We had that right now in an inadvertent way, just with the way that the St. Louis Triple Crown happened, with Eli getting a win, with Cooper being as good as he was, Jet having the season that he had in Chase building. I mean, this is the most organic five-race playoff between four of the best dudes we've ever seen to have it happen. And, like, little by little through these next few weeks, we're pretty much going to see a showdown play out the way that everybody has always daydreamed about. What if we switch the points format up? I mean, in the most organic way, too.
Yeah.
Even the 250 class with the shootouts coming up.
Yeah, it's going to be great.
I don't want to say this, like, because this is like I feel like it's a little bit of a hot take. And it kind of breaks my heart a little bit to say this just because of, you know, how I feel like whenever I was racing, we had a ton of whoops, we had dragon's backs, we had all of this, but there's only been nine whoops this year. Right. And they have all been dozer whoops. There's been no dragon's backs, but there is more guys on the track. So shit, like, could they be onto something with this? I mean, I want to see dozer whoops, or I want to see loader whoops. I want to see 15 of them. I want to see dragon's backs. I want to see the track being tough. You know, that's what I want to see as a fan. But at the same time, I also want to see great racing. So, I mean, I was the first one to say, like, dude, if you keep making the track easier and easier and easier, it's just pretty much going to be an oval, you know, and the guys are just going to be taking left turns. But, you know, I mean, shoot, there's something for it, I feel like. You know, now at this stage of the series, there's a lot of, you know, I mean, all of the top heavy hitters are still in this thing. You know, not as many injuries. And yeah, like, dude, it's freaking awesome racing.
So, Don, I know you didn't hear Eli's interview with Pulp last week, but I know the other two of you guys did. and he's not psyched on this nine whoop thing. Like, he wants big, beefy, manly tracks, and he really wants to get it going on. Mm-hmm. And I get it, because, I mean, that really is probably why he was so dominant for some of those years, is because he was one of three dudes that was willing to do that stuff. But I completely agree with what A-Ray said. Sorry to dumb it down a little bit and make it less competitive for everybody, but fuck, man, it's made this racing unbelievable. Like, if you want to make it really, really good for five guys that can get around it, that's great, and we're going to see a spectacle. And if you really, really know what you're watching, oh my God, what they're doing is unbelievable. Or you can watch 22 guys go to battle for the death on a little bit tamer track that they're all having to push for. And then I think you also see how evenly compared some of these guys are. Like, Shane McElrath and Justin Hill have been riding really, really well lately. Justin's been hurt. Shane's been building for a while. Justin podiumed last year. They get a fighting chance now, because it's not like, oh man, if I'm not willing to send it on something, I'm going to die, or I'm not going to make a podium. Seems a lot better. I agree with you, A-Ray.
Yeah. Yeah. So,
wow,
dude, I mean, if I'm Jet right now, honestly, like, I mean, we all know that Jet has been the best 450 guy the entire year, you know, the speed, everything. I mean, he's the entire package. But if I'm Jet Lawrence right now, I am pretty much shaking in my boots, honestly. Like, I mean, yes, he's still the fastest guy, you know, there's no doubt about it, right? But at this stage of the championship, you cannot give Cooper Webb an inch, because he's going to take a mile every single time. This is his stage of the series. This is usually whenever he starts clicking stuff off. He's not going to get rattled. And, you know, I mean, he just seems to be getting stronger and faster throughout the entire series. I mean, dude, Cooper Webb, man, he's on it right now.
Yeah.
He's a bulldog.
I texted in the group chat, like, that second 48 group or the final session of qualifying, I don't know if I've ever seen Cooper Webb go so fast. That was unbelievable. And he was just doing lap after lap.
And it was like he was on the edge. It was like he was out of his comfort zone, and he was pushing. He was trying to make a statement. He was pitching it into the corners. Like, I mean, he was going for it, right? And and he was taking chances, because, I mean, you know, I guess, I mean, even in the interviews, he was saying that he's been working on speed. So, I mean, it looks like it's showing.
If you rewatch that raw video from A Group, sorry, Don, but he got the start that Eli got in that and he got the practice start that Eli got in his heat race. He was gone, and then he was ripping in that first lap. You know, so I completely agree with you, A-Ray, that his first lap intensity is there, which he doesn't usually have. And we kind of had questioned that had went away, because that was a surprise that he had had at the first part of the season. And then we heard that he had picked up like some sort of arm, wrist, hand, whatever injury, and that maybe dinged it a bit. But it looks like it's back now, because in those first laps of the 450 race on Saturday, he has the king of early race intensity, Ken Roczen, right behind him. And he held him off tit for tat and didn't let Ken get a wheel on him. Yep. And then in the last three laps, when Chase had gotten clear and was going for his attack, he held him off again. So, yeah, I think Coop is really the complete package right now. Qualifying pace has been good. He's got aggression. Loves the bike. Loves what Gilly's done to it. Loves what Peanut's got set up, too. So he's on it right now.
Yeah, and that's another.
What did he say in the press conference?
Was
the jacket thing? It's a pulp thing.
No. J-Law posted something like Coop talking dirty in the press conference.
Yeah, he said jacket off. They're talking about it was just a weird.
Oh, did take the jacket off? Yeah. Not jack off.
Yeah, he was.
I think it was a play.
He
on
was
words.
The only guy that didn't do the parade lap with a jacket on, and it was fucking cold. Like, if I wish that they would have given me his jacket so I could have worn it that whole night, because I was freezing. And so even when he did that, and I watched him jump through the rhythm lane, I was like, oh, okay, everybody else did, but you. And then when it came up in the press conference, I just heard that he made everybody laugh, but I haven't seen it yet. Yeah.
Have you guys seen that SMX Cum Instagram? I think Cooper follows that, because he seems the last 3 weeks, at every point he can, he seems to make a reference. He likes to say coming a lot lately on podium speeches.
Bro,
he's definitely leaning into
it. There are a couple moments through the day when I'm like listening to the broadcast where I'm just like, pause, like, dude, yes. there's some fucking funny stuff that happens just like through the day, but I mean, like, of course it is. But yeah, the SMX Cum thing, I didn't know about that until somebody showed it to me, and now when I'm listening to a podium interview, that's all I hear.
Yeah, my family loves it. My mom even's like, oh, there's one.
Yikes. So Jet just got a horrible start. Did he spin on the grate, or he got bumped? No, Malcolm bumped him.
Yeah, him and Malcolm.
He was bad already, though.
Yeah, it wasn't great, but I think after him and Malcolm touched, it was like 6th or 17th, I think, at one point.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was back.
Dude, such a bummer for Malcolm, too. Funny. Of like, minding his own business, and then Malcolm's entire race gets decided by a split-second bump, you know.
And then Tomac had a horrible start as well.
Yeah. He went down. Yeah,
they were pretty close.
He went down.
Going through the first turn, like, you can see the two of them with each other. And then Eli, I know that they do the replay, and they show Jet and Malcolm coming together, but if you look just a few feet ahead, Eli does, like, botch the turn a little bit and cost him some time. I have to wonder how Eli's left ankle is doing right now. Like, I'm sure he's fine, whatever, but he definitely put some force on that thing a couple times through the day, because he dabs his ankle in that first turn, and then he dabs the same ankle, and it's the Achilles ankle again when he goes down after the finish line. And I want to say there was one more somewhere else through the day where he kind of torqued it. But, yeah, he was fast. He looks fine. The battle that those two were having, too, I was very excited to see that go on. But I think a little mistake by Eli in the sand right after Jet passed him pretty much ended any retaliation on that one. And then the almost run-in and the bull turn later when they're in traffic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hey, Ray, before we move on from, like, the star guys, so time qualifying. J-Coop, Eli, Webb, they all were just on it, especially the last session. But all their bikes look good, but they all look completely different to me. I don't know. Is that something you noticed, too?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely something, you know, I mean, all three of the guys, they definitely have like a different riding style, you know, and that just goes to, you know, how good Gilly is at his job, right? Like, to just sort of, you know, sort of see how each guy has like their riding style, like say Eli, right? Eli rides, you know, he sits pretty far back on the seat and he likes his rear end high and his front end a little bit lower. You know, and then, you know, Cooper Webb, you know, he likes to cut down. Jay Coop, he's like lightning fast in qualifying usually, carries good roll speed, and it looks like he likes his bike pretty balanced. So yeah, I mean, it's just, you know, different guys different things. And I think, you know, they have a great suspension guy. And I was going to say something about Cooper Webb a little bit earlier. It's like, this is his first year on this motorcycle. You know, I mean, a lot of these guys, whenever they change brands, it takes them a year, year and a half, 2 years to really get comfortable, especially in Supercross. And it's like, he jumped on this thing, you know, he had, you know, he didn't look, you know, the best in SMX. And then, you know, even in Paris, whenever we went over, and then it's like something clicked. And like, I think he was talking about how he did some testing with Gilly and he got comfortable right away. And then he's been a different Cooper Webb ever since. So that just goes to show how good that Yamaha is and how those star boys, they have it all dialed in. And it's like, they've been struggling with starts, but for some reason this weekend, all of them are just rocketing out of the gate.
Yeah.
I mean, they must be really, really going to work down there.
Mm-hmm.
Those two heat race starts were amazing.
Eli's was ridiculous. Like, unreal.
Me and Air D looked at each other like, oh my God, did you see that? Like, everybody that was standing next to the track, everyone was just like, holy shit, what was that? And then
it was like Chase's a couple weeks ago.
But then, like, so we just saw the first 25 feet out of the gate where he has half a bike on everybody. We didn't see when you got down closer to the first turn how much more time he had pulled on everyone. Like, yeah, the whole start was insane. Mm-hmm. His start in the main event was good, too. He went right back to the same spot. But, I really think that section just where everybody had kept passing over and how different the dirt would be in the entry to that first turn because it crossed two lanes of very different racetrack, I'm sure that was something to factor in going into that turn. So not to like take over, but on the Cooper thing that you were talking about, Avery, like everything you said is straight on. Like, so I was talking to somebody pretty close to it this weekend, and like there was no Gilly testing that happened before the SMX rounds or before they went to Paris. It wasn't until after that they finally got that figured out, and he's super impressed by what Gilly does. You know, he's got the touch, and it was cool that Eli, as you know, that's Eli's guy, and that's who got brought to start with Eli, but he's working for everybody and he's able to figure it all out. And then the three different power setups that they have on the bikes is pretty unique too. You know, we know that when Cooper rode SMX, he was on Eli's spec and it was too powerful and he didn't like it. And then they dialed it back, and then he's got the hydro clutch. And then Justin Cooper liked a little bit of the power delivery that Cooper's bike had. So then he started using all of that stuff, but then he's now gone away from the hydraulic clutch and is back on a cable clutch. So to everything that you boys said, three very different bikes with three very different riders, but as we know, a star, they're willing to do whatever it takes to make a guy comfortable.
Yeah.
Hey, Ray, would you, if you were racing this year, would you put a hydro on your bike?
No, man, I'm a cable guy. I don't know. I like the Magura and the Brembos. I'm not sure what brand of hydraulic clutches the Yamaha's using.
Brembo, I think.
It's a Brembo.
Brembo. Brembo. I don't know. I don't know. I haven't ridden a Yamaha with the hydraulic clutch. I always liked the cable. So I just liked the feel of the cable. It always worked well for me. So I don't know. Maybe that was something that I should have tried whenever I was racing. Maybe my starts would be a little bit better, but not sure. And I'm curious too, like with the whole Sexton thing, we've heard in interviews and stuff like that, he's working on the bike, he's working on the suspension chassis, and he's also working on the engine too. I'm curious what they're sort of searching for on the KTM engine. If they're searching for like more power or how he likes the delivery. I believe on the Honda, I think last year, you know, when they let like the Racer X guys like ride the factory bikes, they were talking about how I think smooth Jet's bike was, but how hard hitting Sexton's bike was. And I mean, and we've rode just like the stock version of the KTM too, and just seen how and felt how like smooth the power is. So I'm wondering if that's something that they're chasing, sort of trying to get that electric feel.
Damn, interesting. I wish I could.
On the chase note, you know, as we've like talked about so many times, he seemed like he was riding the KTM as aggressive as he rode the Honda. Like there were a couple times, even when he goes for that pass on Ken and he really, really stretches it out over that three as he's close to the tough blocks. Haven't seen him make that kind of attempt a lot on the orange bike, but that was what he was doing a lot on the red bike. And then in that switchback section too, you know, A-Ray, you said the guys were banking off of those little berms that were built in there. Chase was exploding that berm every single time. I was like kind of surprised at how hard he was hitting them. He looked like way, mm-hmm. way, way more powerful than I would think that you would want to, almost like time consuming in a way. And then in that last lap, when he's going for the attack on Cooper and he slammed the berm after the finish line, that kind of botched that whole, what could have been the last lap, but he was ripping, even throwing the bike, you know, into a pretty good scrub before he made a move on Ken too.
Yeah. Do you guys think if had he been able to get by Ken before, maybe he seemed to take a little break at going after him, do you think he could have chased down Cooper? Mm-hmm. I think he was maybe a little bit faster than Webb, it seemed like.
Yeah, no, I think so too. I mean, if he had a little bit more time, or if he had, you know, a little bit more time behind Cooper, I think he would have made something happen. But yeah, I mean, unfortunately, he just got stuck behind Kenny for a long time, and by the time he got around Kenny, it was a little too late. And then I think he made a push there towards the end of the main, but then made a mistake, and that was sort of like took the wind out of his sails that last lap.
I mean, two back-to-back mistakes.
Were you guys expecting Eli to win this weekend? You know, like because like he won the last race. Did you think like, oh, the floodgates are open, Eli's back? And then that heat race, right?
Yeah. The heat race was hard though because there wasn't a ton of guys in it.
Yeah,
Kenny got a bad start, I think, in it, I believe.
I was like, oh, it's on, it's on. Eli's gonna win all the last few races, you know. But like, bad start, didn't really have the pace in the main. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought the same, that he was getting ready to go on a tear, and even watching in time qualifying from the very, very top of the stadium, he would finish a hot lap and then immediately look at the scoreboard to see where it was and then come in, do something real quick, go right back out and try again. So he was definitely going for it. But then, yeah, just the way that the main event shaped out for both him and Jet, with losing some spots, him going down the way he did, having to pass a lot of the same guys, I think, twice. Yeah, that was not the way that it needed to be.
Yeah, I'd like to see the lap times of the main event with Eli, because it looked like he was running the pace. Obviously, I mean, him and Jet were going through the pack pretty good in, you know, early stages, you know, until those mistakes happened. You know, I don't know if he was sort of off the pace. I just feel like it was just, you know, wrong place, wrong time, sort of bad start.
I think at the end, after he almost ran into Jet and after the whoops, I think that really just kind of put the kibosh on everything, because that was a big push that he had done to catch back up again after the initial pass. I mean, they were both going very, very fast. They were faster than a lot of the guys that were around them. And I think had some of those incidents not happened, they would have gotten Jason. Both of them would have gotten Jason at a certain point. Dude, Jet made up 6 seconds and 6 minutes in the last 6 minutes to wind down Jason and reel up to him. But then such mm-hmm. a good ride by Jason to defend that line and keep it going, because
dude, in the last turn,
because otherwise we're not tied in points. And you not to like put words or anything out there, but there is definitely like a contingent of like, hey, us old guard guys definitely have to not make life hard for him. We're not going to bully the kid or anything like that, but we have to stop him from doing this and taking over right now. Let's all make sure that we don't let him win too much right now.
Yeah. Anton, good. I totally blanked on the whole Eli Jett almost T-bone. That was insane. You think Lars, if you're Lars and the guys in the camp, you probably got to be like, yo, that was a close one. Maybe no more cutting down like
that. Well, that, but then like two lappers even in the position two, and you just came through the whoop. So like kind of another situation where it's perfect scenario for chaos to go on. But yeah, the moves that both guys were making, I think that Jet was riding at like the limit for him. Because even right after that pass that he does make on Eli and gets going, he overjumps the finish line, jumps into the tough blocks, and I was standing behind the mechanics area when that happened, and Eli was right there on him again. And I was like, oh, okay, are they going to pressure him for a few more laps and make him do this? And I think that right now, for real, Jet is figuring out racing through the pack like he's never had to before, because all last summer were great starts and he didn't have to work through people. And then having these guys on his tail all the time, going to push him. As soon as you slip up one time, they're right there. And he hasn't had to deal with that, but... shit, 2 weeks from now, we could be like, man, another learning lesson that the kid picked up in 5 days. Like, he did it again.
Yeah. I mean, 21 points is a lot to lose in the last 2 weeks. You know, that's nuts, you know. And we got ourselves a championship now, man. It seems like, I mean, we're tied up, you know. And I don't know. I'm excited. Like, I'm a fan. Like, I'm just – I'm on the edge of my couch every weekend. I love it. It's awesome.
You're going this weekend too, right?
Yep. I'll be in Nashville. You know, so yeah, we have some cool stuff on the O'Neill side. You know, we have, you know, it's for St. Jude, so we have some cool jerseys that we did, you know, for some of our guys that we'll be showing off this weekend. So that's awesome. Yeah, I'm stoked. Yeah, so are you guys going?
What's the forecast like?
Oh, it's going to rain, I think, Saturday. Small chance.
Oh, shit.
Again.
Oh.
But, it's what, 30, 40% chance, I think, right now on Saturday. But, I mean... mm-hmm. Tennessee, heck, I mean, it could be zero chance and it rain, or it could be 100% chance and not rain. So you never know.
But it's hot here this week. Like, it's in the 80s up here in St. Louis. It's a 4 or 5 hour drive down there. And I'm looking at the weather and it's like 84, 83, 81, 84 till Friday. And then it cools off. So it'll be nice for it to be like in the high 60s on Saturday. Yeah. And even if it does rain. But then as we saw last year during the day race, this year is a night race, so it's okay. But that Tennessee dirt gets hard packed really, really fast. So maybe a little bit of moisture could help.
Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah. That dirt up there they got in Nashville, man, it's weird. It's not that good. Yeah. So, but no, okay. it's going to the bikes. I want to talk about the bikes a little bit just because, like, I geek out on it, right? It's so crazy to think that, like, 10 years ago, everything has changed setup wise, you know. 10 years ago, you know, guys, they wanted forks to just not move at all, and their shock to be low in the rear. Everyone was cutting subframes. I mean, you had 6 foot tall dudes cutting subframes and having just like a stiff, low, slow, just shock with bricks in the forks, right? And now it's gone to more balanced motorcycles, even a little bit more of a stink bug with like a softer front end for like better cornering. You know, it's crazy to me to see that, like, you go from like the JS7 setup where, you know, I don't know, everything was just like super stiff in the front end, low in the rear, to now you have a guy like Eli, who's one of the best in the sport, who has a rear end that's all the way, you know, super high with a low front end sort of diving down. Like, but at that point, I mean, you're seeing less guys tuck the front, right? Or wash the front end. You know, you would see guys every weekend, like Marty or Joey Sabachi or guys like that, like just washing the front end out on sort of like ice skate turns like we've seen last weekend in Foxborough. And you don't see that as much now, I feel like, just because of the way the bikes, and the teams have learned, to have a little bit more of like a softer front end. I just think it's super cool.
Yeah, totally.
Should we take a break?
Yeah, but real quick, just props. Justin Hill was ripping randomly. And then I don't know what happened to Barsha.
11th, 9th?
I think he ended up top 10, yeah. And Shane was ripping. Barsha faded. Oh, no.
We'll talk about that after the break. All
right. Shout out to McElrath, too, because Shane was hauling. Shane's been building the last couple weeks. Every time we talk on How Was Your Weekend, he's saying about how the improvements are there. And then this week was a breakthrough until he got he took a handlebar to the back of his elbow and his arm went numb. Ooh. So
yeah, and that was like last lap or two,
last
right?
couple laps, yeah. Yeah. But Shane's on it, and do you think about the last 2 years that Shane's had, how many different bikes he's had? I mean, literally looked like he was at rock bottom. Like when I saw him at Unadilla, and I think that the stress of everything had just kind of taken its toll on him. Then to see what he's doing right now. It's very good. It's always good to see a guy build.
Yep. Who is he battling with that hit him in the elbow?
He told me, but I got to play it back. I don't remember offhand.
I'm trying to remember who's around him.
Can you imagine that? How that felt?
Yeah, that cannot feel good.
He said he tried to do like a section, and then after that, he's like, I can't. Ugh. On the Justin Hill thing too, dude, props to Little Hill. He definitely does not care who's around him because Jet passed him. Did you see him go back for Jet in the turn before the
signal? Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
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 It's like tight.
So sick.
He wasn't giving an inch.
No.
Yeah, that was awesome. All right, we're going to take a break. Back for more.
X-Brand Goggles was launched in 2008, and over the past two decades, they've earned a reputation as one of the elite eyewear choices in our sport. The newest offering, the Lucid Goggle, features an XDO injection molded lens for exceptional optical clarity, as well as superior protection against the massive roost that modern day four-stroke bikes throw. At Swapmoto Live, we love the Lucid Goggle for its huge field of vision. Check them out at xbrand.com. That's eksbrand.com. If you're on the West Coast and you're looking for a one-stop shop, you need to visit the guys at STR Motorsports, formerly known as Shock Therapy Racing. With over 30 years of experience, your bike will be in great hands. Whether you're looking for a custom performance suspension revalve or just a basic rebuild, they've got you covered. STR also offers motor building services. Whether you need a stock engine rebuilt or a full-blown race motor, they're the place to go. Conveniently located in Wildomar, California, they're very close to Lake Elsinore and Parrish Raceway. Additionally, they maintain a full stock of oils, tires, and tubes. They can get pretty much anything you need. Check them out at shocktherapysuspension.com.
Bill's Pipes has been producing championship-winning high-performance exhaust systems for all types of off-road motorcycles since 1974. Whether you're a mini racer or simply a premix burning diehard, our two-stroke pipes and silencers deliver unbeatable performance gains. Our four-stroke exhaust systems provide affordable performance gains and are available for motocross, off-road, ATV, and side-by-side applications. Best of all, every product from Bill's Pipes is produced and assembled in the USA. Check us out at billspipesusa.com.
Did you know that in addition to being some of the coolest people on motocross, the crew at WUSA are the official importers of Talon, Kite, and Edge hubs, as well as the leading resource for DID and Excel rims. Through the years, we've tested plenty of aftermarket wheels, and the wheel building crew at WUSA can't be beat. WUSA is the source for all things associated with wheels, including sprockets, spoke wrenches, tire irons, and more. Mention Swapmoto Live when ordering anything from WUSA and get a nice little discount too. Check them out at WUSA.com.
Hey guys, it's Ryan Villapoto. Now that I'm living the retired life and not bound to factory team sponsors, I'm able to choose my partners when it comes to building my bikes. I choose Backyard Designs to create my motorcycle graphics because they do a great job. Their kits look great, go on easy, and last long.
Backyard Design has the most comprehensive and user-friendly graphic website in the sport. Use the discount code SWAPMOTO at checkout for a discount at backyarddesignsusa.com.
G'day guys, this is 9-time X Games gold medalist Jared McNeil. Off the motocross bike, I spend plenty of time cross-training on my intense mountain bike. From the super fast and efficient Sniper cross-country bike to the aggressive Primer and Tracer trail bikes or even the amazing Taser e-bike. Every intense is designed and developed in the United States and built to the highest standards. A life on two wheels certainly includes pedals too. So give the crew at IntenseCycles.com a look.
What's up? This is Christian Craig. As a motocross racer, being in top physical shape is a must, and my favorite way to train is cycling. And whether it's road biking or mountain biking, I rely on Roy Cyclery to keep my bikes in perfect running order.
Roy Cyclery has been servicing Old Town Upland, California since 1962. Mention the Swapmoto Live podcast for additional discounts in the show.
Guts Racing, the leaders in seat technology. Go to gutsracing.com today and design your custom seat cover. We try to ship all custom seat covers within 36 business hours. We also offer free shipping to the lower 48 states. Once again, that's gutsracing.com.
Over the past 40 years, EVS Sports has established themselves as the leaders in innovation and technology when it comes to designing protection gear for today's motocross riders. Athletes like RJ Hampshire, Kyle Chisholm, Axel Hodges, and Travis Pastrana all wear EVS when they race, ride, or whatever Travis decides to do that day. Check out EVS-sports.com to gear up like the pros.
All right, guys, welcome back to the Kickstart Podcast presented by Pro Taper. I made some money back this weekend. You know, I placed three bets, but I was all conservative. So actually, I didn't make any money back. I ended up even, right?
It's still fun.
So I bet $50 on Eli because I thought, you know, it was coming back, and I bet $50 on Cooper to win. And then I was like, I haven't really bet on the 250 class, but I was like, yeah, maybe something different will happen. So I put $50 on VR. So obviously, you know, I lost two and I won one. So I was even on the weekend. So I didn't lose any money, so that's better than I've done the first two weekends, I bet. But I don't know, maybe I'll go big in Nashville.
There you go.
How did you do?
Yeah, not great. I think I kind of rushed it this week because it's weird. I had looked at the bets before I did my inside SML, and I was like, all right, that's who I'm going to place bets on. And then I never actually did. Mm-hmm. And so Friday at night, I was like, oh, crap. And I went on real late, and I thought I placed bets on Tomac, Sexton, Hammerker and someone, oh, Deegan too. So mm-hmm. I like going through the race after the 250 main event, and then the last couple laps of the 40 main event when I thought Chase maybe had a chance, I was like, dude, this is gonna be a good weekend again. And then I checked my account after the race, and apparently I just made like four bets on Eli Tomac. So
how can I let you even do
that? I don't know. I did four $50 bets on Tomac, so not a great weekend.
Well, Sam, does that mean I'm buying lunch today?
Yeah, I think so.
Well, I came across even, but you lost.
Yeah.
All right, we'll go to El Rey Tacos and get some lunch. But you guys are going to create accounts this week and get in on the action, right?
Yes, I have my account made, and I'm curious to see what they're going to have Jed at this weekend. You know, he's coming off two bad weekends. Mm-hmm. If he's still going to be like sort of the favorite, or if we'll be able to get in there and make some extra money. So, I'm probably going to end up betting on Jet because I think that it's a must win situation for him. And I think that he's going to capitalize on it. So, that's my predictions.
I'd like to hear how these odds go for Jet after these last few weeks. Cause like when this whole thing got started and like, sure, there was no money to be made if you bet on Jet, it was the sure thing. And then now it's like, let's see. So that's, I'd like to see how this goes, especially just because, now that we're a few weeks into this program and to really see the ups and the downs of it, because those first few weeks, I think there is so much questioning of like, well, how are the odds set or what's this or what's that? And then I'm sure the showdown's just going to be straight chaos.
Yeah, I wonder how those odds look.
Hmm.
Yeah, right? Yeah. I'd hate to be the odds maker on that.
Yeah, that's a lot of guys.
Yeah, I might go out on a whim. I might just, I mean, depending on, do we know what Thrasher's injury status is, or is he okay, or is he racing, or what's he got?
I think he's okay.
If he's okay, I might put a little bit of money on him just because, like,
oh, hometown boy. That's
Hometown boy, like, he does good at these events, you know, these showdowns, you know, when everyone's always together, if you know the track's super gnarly or anything like that, like he sort of likes to capitalize on that. It hasn't been that good of a year for him, so I think that, you know, I mean, he needs to do something prior, or you know, before the end of the season. So I might put a little bit of money on him to do something.
Yeah.
All right, guys. It's betonline.ag. You find Supercross under the automotive racing tab. Also, I was thinking about we're welcoming this week Alpha Motocross Dynamics to the podcast.
Ooh.
And
hey, Ray, you need to get on that. Me too.
Yes. No, 100%. I was talking to Brandon the whole weekend talking. Well, it's like 5 a.m. in the morning and he's sending me Zwift invites and I'm like, bro, I haven't gotten up yet, but I need to start getting up for the Zwift invites. But super cool for Hartraft. I was on the phone with him. So every single one of his guys were in the main event this past weekend. He had Logan Leitzel. He had Thomas Welch. He's got Bryce Shelley. I believe he's got one other. And then he's also has Cabrera Bowser, who made that gnarly pass on Cole Davies that last lap of the future mm-hmm. race too. So he's got some pretty good alphas out there.
Yeah. So Alpha Motocross Dynamics does riding coaching, diet and nutrition, training. And then the thing that interested me was like the mental strategies, right? Because like who is better at mental strategies than Cooper Webb?
Oh, yeah, right? Totally. I didn't think about that.
Yeah, I mean, dude.
And one of the biggest benefits of these programs like this that are popping up now, I think most dirt bike riders are pretty unorganized. And I think this brings like a lot of organization to your life, especially if you're trying to better yourself with your racing career and whatnot. Mm-hmm. It's something, a whole part of it that you don't even have to worry about or stress about.
Yeah.
See, I've been doing the Twan Fit.
So just before.
Sorry, Don. I've been doing Twan Fit. So last week I watched the Triple Crowns back.
What's Twan
Fit? Well, you got a 25-pound-year-old psychopath that you get to deadlift all the time and throw over your shoulder. So that's good. A lot of running and some cycling and stuff there too. But then after St. Louis, I bought like a 15-pound kettlebell. And so for all of the Triple Crowns, I watched all of the 450 ones. And every alternating lap, I do the squat with the kettlebell and my legs were on fire afterwards, like whole lap, do a squat and then do a recovery. So we're getting there, but I think the alpha thing, I'll just hit up Brandon and actually have a real program put together.
Yeah. I mean, it's just super cool to see, you know, the things that Brandon's doing, you know, with the alpha thing, you know, I mean, him and I mean, he's the best man at my wedding. Right. And we talk pretty much every day. He talks about his guys and you know, it's just super cool to see, right? Like, I mean, he's super motivated with it. He loves it. You know, I mean, he's out there, you know, Zwifting with his guys. He's talking to his guys daily, you know, giving them advice. I mean, he was at the top of the sport. I mean, he was one of the only guys for a long time to get podiums on the TLD team, on the KTM team. He was, you know, he was a top 10 guy in Supercross in the 450 class. You know, I mean, he was a great outdoor guy. And I mean, that was his MO, right? I mean, he was the brick. He was freaking gnarly, right? I mean, you guys have seen him. We've all been on mountain bike rides with the guy. I mean, he's a good dude and he knows his stuff and he's got Cooper Webb right there with him as well. So that's super cool to see. And it's just, you know, I wish these things were available for me, like whenever I was growing up, right? Because dude, I thought that I was freaking Lance Armstrong back whenever I was, I don't know, in 2015 or whatever, but I didn't know shit about training. I'll be honest with you. I didn't know anything. And I wish that there was something like this available whenever I was early in my career. And I think that it would have helped me a lot, you know? So now it's super cool. I mean, he has programs for, you know, weekend warriors. He has programs for guys, you know, of every skill level. You know, he caters to your schedule. It's super cool. You know, I mean, I think he has one kid who trains his ass off, but he works nights, you know, he works every night, like he works the night shift. So, yeah, I mean, it's super cool, like I said, and he, you know, he caters to your schedule and, yeah, it's super nice.
AlphaMotocrossDynamics.com.
Mm-hmm.
We're waiting for the Cooper Webb commercial read. I'm excited to get that.
Oh yeah.
I can only imagine how this one's going to be.
Yeah.
Oh man. Yeah.
I was almost gonna task you with getting it this weekend, Anton. But I was like,
I could. Yeah, we can get that done.
Yeah. But yeah. So Aray, that picture you sent us this weekend was pretty impressive. It.
What did I send you guys?
I think, and you posted in your story.
Yeah. Jersey was a bit tight, but I gotta go up a size in pants too. It was a whole thing, but you know, yeah.
36?
No. 34. The 32s are just
okay.
Like, I mean, I can squeeze into them, but it ain't pretty. It is not pretty.
I'm 34s too.
Yeah. So it's not good.
Oh man,
dude, I've gained so much weight, dude. I'm fat.
Do we need to take the factory edition KTM over to race tech to get stiffened up a little bit?
Nah, dude, that thing works like a dream. I don't even want to touch it. It works good.
Okay, I'm just saying.
Needs an oil change and air filter, though.
Race tech might do that. It seemed to do a lot.
Yeah. Dude, I didn't get over there last week.
I was going to ask about that.
Yeah, I got a little sidetracked.
Yeah. Should we test some race tech conversion kit on that?
Yeah, if you want. It works great. I'll just give you the ones off the 300. Because I'm going to get a 300 back.
Yeah, maybe we'll try that.
Yeah, dude, the Race Tech spring conversion for the KTM forks or air forks it's good. It's so plush. Love it. You know, because the two-stroke ain't getting raced this weekend. I was all full of, like, two-stroke, you know, fury, ready for the two-stroke race, and then they postponed it. So it's this weekend, but now I've lost interest.
I need to sell my YZ250. So, yeah, if anyone needs it.
Did you sell your 450F too, or no?
No, I already sold that thing.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, I sold it. Everything's for sale, bro. Everything's for sale.
Wow. The KX500?
No, not that one.
How's the Elsinore?
It's going to be a yard ornament.
Yeah, you can.
Yeah, how is Elsinore?
The Elsinore, it's almost done. I mean, like, I'm still waiting on the suspension. I had to get a steering stem made. So the steering stem is like getting made at like some machine shop right now. And then we're waiting on some parts for the engine, and then it should be starting to get bolted together. So it's almost done.
Nice.
Hey, Anton, the clip you got of Hammerker casing the triple, flying over the berm, just gracefully landing in the mud and dismounting. When that happened, were you just like, yes, yeah. I got it.
Well, because like, okay, so I'm filming and I'm like watching him go around and I'm like, I'm going to do Seth for a lap. Like I got a fast lap of Seth and like time's running down. So like, this be a good one. When he starts that rhythm, as soon as he took off, I was just like, oh shit. And then he clanks that one and I was just like, oh no. I had heard that Towers had went over the berm. After the finish line, and then I saw like a super muddy Star Yamaha bike, and I was like, oh, I wonder what happened there. And so I had heard that, like, oh yeah, there's just these big like swamp monsters on the backs of some of the berms. When he went over that thing, I like had to set the camera down because I was laughing so hard. And then when the forklift came out, I then again had to set the camera down because I was laughing so hard, because I've never seen that before. I felt like I was at an F1 race where they have to like,
you should have seen Pulley, dude.
I did see that one on TV. Pulley
couldn't get his body out.
Right? Dude, Pulley got like four more guys stuck.
Yeah, I did see that on TV.
Trying to get him out.
So, yeah.
Yep. So good. I think we should have one of those mud pits.
Every week.
Like every round. I think it was awesome.
You know, when the machine had pulled the bike out, I was like, oh, that's just like Talking Boy at the Suzuki intro at JGR.
Yeah, I did that at Seattle one year in the main event, and Christina was very pissed off at me whenever I was on Cycle Trader. And yeah, I mean, I was done for the night. I mean, my bike, I couldn't get it out.
Really?
Yeah, nuts.
What year was that? Was that 18?
17.
Okay. Oh, the crazy one. 17. The crazy one. Yeah.
That night, the track was so rutted. Oh my God, it was so bad.
That year was your best look, dude. I think that's when I met you at your little team shoot.
Moose?
Oh, yeah. That was 18. That was 18. 2017, I was still like FXR and wearing all
that. Oh,
yeah.
No, never mind.
I think his best look was the fill in on Yamaha when he had the O'Neill gear and the hand guards. Yeah.
That's true.
Yeah. But I'll give credit where credit's due. I did like some of those Moose setups. I'm not going to lie.
Yeah, that whole team was actually pretty sick.
The helmets that went with it too, when you guys always had the custom painted helmets with the snowboard company.
What was that? What was that logo that was on those helmets a lot?
Never Summer.
I think Taft had it. Never Summer. Yeah. What was that?
Snowboards, right?
Yeah, it was a snowboard company that had snowboards and stuff. I never got a snowboard, although I did ask. But
you just had the logo.
Yeah, I never got a snowboard. I never seen any of that. Yeah.
Huh.
I don't even think I got a T-shirt. But yeah, I still have all of that
cool
stuff
logo
in Tennessee.
It made
I have
the
like
helmets look
10
cool.
of those helmets. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a good team.
Hey, were those
saying like his look when he was on the filling on Yamaha? Like he had the. Were you in a rye? You were in a rye, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But and then he kept wearing the monster hats and t-shirts for like Socks. 3 years afterwards.
Bro, he showed up in Paris Supercross in the monster scarf. It was fucking great.
It was fucking great. Yep. I laughed so hard. Yeah, that actually came up on my memories the other day. I had a monster. Dude, I still have it. I have a monster scarf.
The,
I have
you
all
wore
the monster
Paris.
Beanies, every single hat, all the shirts, all the hoodies. I have all the team shit. Like, dude, it's all fucking in my closet.
That man.
That's sick.
Dude, I want to do something on this one day. There is something about the Monster Energy M-Claw that fucking, it does not matter that if we don't drink it or not, we all want it. Like, I have those cycling bottles. Yeah. They're the coolest shit.
It's so true.
I throw it on my bicycle, and I'm like, yeah, I'm one of Mitch's guys. This is sick.
Yeah. It's so true.
Yeah, dude. Like, I mean, look at Rango. Doesn't Rango have a claw tattoo?
Yes, he does.
Yep.
No, he has a fox tattoo.
No, he's got the
Monster
tattoo,
too.
Yeah, he's mm-hmm. got both.
Yeah, he got them both.
Oh, my God, dude.
He got the whole rear fender done on his back, too.
Dude, does he have a Team Fried tattoo?
Fried's dead.
I don't know, maybe.
I got the stickers.
Yeah, Fried's
dead.
Yeah.
dead, though. That's I got the stickers.
It's weird. I have a lot of Team Fried stickers. I have, like, the start to the finish. I have the complete, like, Pokemon cards now.
All right, 250s. Danger Boy, solid ride. McAdoo. Did you talk to him how his weekend? Or was in the press conference, did he say... I wonder if he settled in realizing that, you know, the points play there.
Sorry.
Long, awkward.
No, yeah, the alarm went off, the noon whistle. I didn't talk to Cameron afterwards, but I do think that, yeah, that had to be a factor of just the, I'm going to take a second, he's so far gone. I didn't get him for how was your weekend, but yeah. I got Hayden. But
And once he got past Vial, if there's anyone he needs to really put points
it's
on,
Vial.
Him, it's Vial.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But dude, did you see the Brodies when he came out of the turn?
Yeah, yeah, for sure.
A couple times, mm-hmm. two or three times, he had a big back end kick out. Yeah. And I was like, no.
Man, props to him though. Like, knock on wood, he's had very few moments this year. And I wonder, I would like to talk to him like at the end of the year and just see if he's backed it down a little bit or what. Because.
Backed it down to 100%?
Yeah, not 110.
I wonder if that little injury, too, like coming in, not being at full speed, knowing you can't push it to that whole way. Like, if you have a little bit of a restriction on you, maybe that's what he's always needed.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
Yeah.
Man, if he wins the title, like, how is that? Start the series with your dick out and then just come back and win from
every point matters.
From that kickoff.
Yeah, that'd be insane.
Insane. So Deegan seemed pretty reserved on your How Was Your Weekend. He didn't welcome you to the danger zone.
No. Yeah, he was pretty good. I think that, like, he'd done the press conference, and then they brought him over, and he did his two interviews that he does after a win and stuff like that. So that was good. But, yeah, I mean, I end of a long day, and he said what he needed to say. But it was good just to see Hayden do the laps and – come back, especially after that, because during a month-long break and the position that he's in, there's no better way for him to come out than to get that win and then to put some of the things that he worked with on technique and stuff, you know, going and doing that day at Moto Sandbox with Kenny. And they're definitely learning, they're definitely figuring it out, and so the kid's only going to get better and better as it goes on. But that was a good showing by
him. Was he the only star guy that went to ride to Sandbox?
Dude, Hayden's the only guy doing a lot of stuff, because I also noticed he was the only guy in black and white gear while everybody else was in blue gear, and I was just like, that's weird.
Interesting.
But yeah, it's every week. It does not matter what race you go to. It is hilarious to see how long that autograph line is. It's nuts.
Yeah. Was Brian and Marissa there?
No, just Brian. Because Marissa was with Haley at our NASCAR.
Was that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. That's insane.
That's got to be, like, crazy, right? Because I remember when my daughters both had soccer games, like, in different places. So Eileen and I would split. I mean, this is opposite sides of the country, different
Such
sports.
An elite level.
Like, at the highest level you can get at. Crazy.
Nuts.
Yeah.
What's up? What is this Deegan YZ250 versus Jace Gypsy Tails two-stroke
I don't know.
Build?
I don't know what that is.
Like, I've only seen... Deegan's video,
Brian's
like, unveiling
right?
it, and then Jace was hitting me up for Ross's phone number, and he said he can't lose this build off. But I don't know what it is. Is it like a debut at this weekend's two stroke race or something? Do you know anything about it, Anton?
No, I think isn't Jace doing some events with Verb, like some races or something? Maybe it's one of those.
Well, they had that.
I know they had the one in Mesquite, but yeah. Maybe they're doing something in Florida too. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. The only thing, like, I just seen that two stroke that Brian built with that shorty pipe. That's all I had seen. Dude, yeah. Also too, green like
rims.
The green rims are sick.
Oh god, dude.
Again, another thing too, like Brian's got a liquid Molly deal. Like that's pretty cool. They have a lot of little like their own beat all the way across that stuff. So Brian, even though he's not racing as much as he was, that man's still a marketing powerhouse.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Dude, we got to talk about Cody Shock's three-year deal.
Yeah.
Dude, that's insane.
That is so cool. Like, I mean, to see where he's came from, like, you know, just being with, like, I believe he was on Club MX's amateur team back in the day. I remember, it was probably, I mean, whenever they had, like, their Olin suspension, it was one of their first years as, like, a Yamaha team, I believe. And just to see how much he's improved and how much better he is now than whatever he was. So just in Supercross, he's just, his trajectory is just, it's so good. And good on him for getting locked down for the next 3 years. That's freaking awesome.
Don, how about just like the other day I was thinking about when this all came out last week, the day at Paris where Hoppe brought him out and we were shooting stuff for boys and like the most, I mean, he's still such a humble and nice guy. He hasn't changed his personality at all, but just this, at that point, all this kid we had no one had heard of, and that was 5 years ago, 6 years ago, maybe.
Yeah, something like that.
That's insane, dude. The trajectory his career has.
Yeah, and then he had the big hiccup.
Yeah.
With Lindsay's team.
Yeah.
The team went away at the last second.
And then even this year, dude. Like, I don't know if he'll ever say how late it happened, but for Phoenix to just clip him last minute like they did. And props to Club for grabbing him when they did and giving him a shot. Mm-hmm. But, just nuts.
Yeah. I mean, it's not. I mean, dude, even think about the year that Cody had last year. The most memorable thing that he had going on was hitting that over-under bridge at Houston. That was it. And that was coming getting hit by a car and all the other problems that he had had. So, I mean,
The
boy's really, really rebuilt himself after, I mean, what had to feel like rock bottom for a little bit. And then for the deal that he has and knowing he gets to do it, you know, because he's ridden at Club for a while through the Phoenix deal, so now he's fully part of it. And just as Cody goes into the next stage of his life, like, he's engaged, he's got a fiance, his mom and dad are up, you know, in the Northeast, so he now gets to go about everything the right way instead of just having a bunch of little loose ends that he has to worry about how he's going to tie them together. Like, I'm so excited.
Yeah, and it's super cool for him too, right? I mean, he's a little bit older, but I mean, he took a different direction, right? I mean, he finished high school, he went to college, he's got a degree, you know, so I mean, he has a backup plan versus like all these other kids, they really don't, right? So, I mean, he's a super smart dude, even off the track. So, it's definitely something that's super cool to talk about.
Yeah.
Right on. Well, shall we wrap this up?
Yeah, there's not much to talk about DVDs, I don't think.
It was snoozy.
A little bit of a snooze fest, yeah.
Yeah.
What do you think, though, still, as this goes on? Because two showdowns now, this could get really, really nuts. Do you see any big shifts happening amongst these top three with two showdowns and one traditional main event to go, or is it kind of set?
I think so, personally, the East Coast. I think we're going to see a lot of the West guys up towards the front in the showdowns, and I think the East Coast guys are going to, if one of them can get a good start and the other guys don't, I think it's going to change things a lot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I think Levi Kitchen is probably the favorite. You know, I think he's the fastest guy, and then after that, I would assume, you know, Deegan, to be honest. I think we're going to see two pro circuit Cowies on the podium, you know, whether that, you know, I think it's going to be like Kitchen and McAdoo on the podium, and then Deegan right there in the mix as well. So, I think those are the three best guys.
If Bet Online had this going and you could put your money down, what would you see as a more believable 250 podium sweep, a star sweep or a PC sweep?
Ooh, that's good.
PC.
Who's the third PC? If Hammaker's good after last weekend, then...
Yeah.
Yeah, probably PC.
Yeah.
It's hard with just the Hammaker situation right now, but you take a week ago, I'd say probably PC.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. PC.
God, that's nuts.
It'd be so nice if Mitch gets some titles this year.
Dude,
after
right?
After the dry spell.
Insane. I'm excited for that. I hope there's actual like bets like that that we can take in the future. Just a little off, not so much position.
And that would make like, as a fan, that would really, because I know on all the other stuff, there's a lot of little details that you could bet into. So this would be really, too, another way to make a lot of money. You know, if you know the stuff backwards and forwards, like if you know the way the shit's going to break, that's a good way to do it.
Yeah. Yeah. Like imagine if you could make a bet on if Webb's going to make a penis type joke on the podium. I'd take that.
That's 100%.
Yeah.
All right. This podcast is headed south.
Wait. Real quick.
You said penis.
Wait, real quick. Since it's going south, did you guys watch Race Day Live?
I did not this week.
Okay.
I was riding.
So I don't know who the blonde girl is. I think it's a different girl this last weekend.
Oh, yeah. We did get some O'Neal jerseys for some NFL players.
Dude, what did she say? She said, like, for shizzle my skrilla, basically. Like, she said the most awkward, like, cringiest thing with all those dudes. It was so hard to watch.
Who are those dudes?
Patriots players. There's a lot of football players this weekend. It was pretty tight, actually. Dude, one of them.
It was so awkward.
The guy that was in the Fox Supreme jersey, he was cool. Introduced him to us in the photo den because he shoots photos of, like, other sports, like he'll go and shoot like a Celtics game and stuff. So that was cool. And he was definitely about it. And he was really, really interested in bikes. So that's fun to see that kind of crossover. And then the one guy that they had, the Nokovic guy, that's like one of Duff's super friends. So he's in the Yamaha team shirt that Duff gave him. So I do like when we have little crossovers like that. There's some stuff that happens where I'm just like, I don't really care. But how many guys came out this weekend and how into it they were, not just because they showed up on behalf of Feld. Like, a lot of those guys were with the Dirt Bike Depot team. So great job to Jack and all the guys over there for making that happen, for you guys for getting them jerseys, A-Ray, because a lot of times it's just, hey, come by the truck for 5 minutes. We'll do a photo op. But they really did make them feel like part of the show.
Yeah. Max and Dirt Bike Depot.
Were you part of the
Did
you organize those O'Neal jerseys, A-Ray?
Yeah, so Max from Dirt Bike Depot at the beginning of the week was, you know, telling me that, you know, they had some NFL players that were showing up. So we got them some jerseys, you know, over with their name, their number, Dirt Bike Depot logo on them for Max. And he was stoked, man. Yeah, all the football players looked like they were having an awesome time. Like one dude, he had his X brand goggles on his head and everything. Like they were all hanging out at the pit, starting the bikes up and everything. They looked like they were having an awesome time. So it was super cool.
So she said, "For shizzle my nizzle."
It wasn't that, but dude, it was pretty close. It was like pretty close to that. If you guys want to bundle up and cringe for a little bit,
did they just look at her? Like, what'd you say?
Well, one of the players said something about he think he revved the bike, and he's like, "I'll stick to my Honda Accord." And then she like put the mic on herself and said something like,
"The
represent." I don't know. It was bad.
There was a comment. So then, like, there was the picture of her with those guys on the No Context Moto Instagram. And then, like, one of the comments was like, "I think I've seen this video." And I was just like, "Yo."
Yes. 100%.
That one was exactly a lot of
stuff. There was a lot of that. Some stuff going around just in the group chats and stuff like that. Yeah, it's a bummer.
Yeah.
But
that's leads to our maturity level for all of us. Yeah.
Yep. 100%. But hey, I mean, people notice the jerseys too, so that's cool.
All right, guys, thanks for tuning in. We're gonna turn this off before it gets worse, and we'll talk to you after the Nashville Supercross.
Since 1991, Pro Taper has led the way in premium control components and prides themselves on providing an exciting, innovative, and complete product line to fulfill the needs of professional racers and weekend riders alike. Through revolutionary ideas like the oversized 1 1/8-inch handlebar and the micro handlebar kit, the only control system purpose-built for youth riders, Pro Taper continues to push the limits and transform how we experience riding our motorcycles. Visit ProTaper.com for more.